It's my absolute honor to welcome and introduce Professor Sujatha Vijayaraghavan, who has been associated with teaching experience at Department of English for the last 34 years in Pondicherry. With her experience, she has offered almost all the courses in the postgraduate syllabus of English literature. And apart from designing and teaching, she has also touched upon several new areas, such as Indian literature, colonial writings in India, feminist studies, and oral literatures. Her specialization covers the fields of post-colonial literatures, oral literatures, Indian writings in English, and most importantly, translation, with an equally active record in research guidance. Now let us talk about some of her achievements, or let us say like her specialized works. The translation of tribal and folklore from different dialects of Tamil to English, titled 100 Tamil Folk and Tribal Tales, published by Orion Black Swan, is a pioneer contribution in the area. A novel published by Penguin titled The Silent One is a long listed novel for the Man Asian Prize. The biography of Kernasu, published by Sahitya Academy, was also translated by Professor Sujatha. Some of her other works are Envisioning Man, 10 Pandi Chinkanam, and they have all been translated into English. Her total publications are 32. And today she will be talking about two different types of texts that she has translated, one from ancient Tamil and one from oral folklore. A very warm welcome to you, ma'am.
Thank you for your kind words of introduction. And I also thank the National Translation Mission for inviting me today. The title of my talk, The Translatability of Literary and Cultural Semiotics. I'm going to address two of these issues today. One is literary and the other cultural. What I propose to do is, I've mentally divided my lecture into two parts. In the first part, I will straight away go to examples based on which I will extend my discussion to arrive at some hypothesis. So apart from the ancient and the tribal tales, ancient classical literature that I've translated, I've brought in several other examples. My very first slide, as I said, I've sliced the entire lecture into two parts. The first, where I will describe certain examples, and the second one, second half, latter half, where we shall arrive at some convincing hypothesis. Now, I'm going to my first slide. You can see this, I'll zoom it for you. Folk songs, the folk songs of southern India. With the definite article, it seems as if there are no other folk songs. Be that as it may, this book was published by Higginbotham's in 1871. And the translator, the person who claims translation of the folk songs of southern India, like several other British scholars, is Charles Gower. In this particular anthology of folk songs that's translated into English from southern languages, as I said, you can see here at the bottom, published in 1871, there is some karkara disturbance. I don't know whether it's because of the weather or something, but I hope that's not a bother. It was published in 1871 by Higginbotham's, which was then called Higginbotham and Co. But prior to that, a little before that, it was also published by Saiva Siddhanta Peravai, which is actually a very learned body. It has its own publication house, And it's the ultimate word on Saiva Siddhanta publications, classical Saiva publications. Why Saiva Siddhanta Karagam published it, we don't know. But you have to see the colonial imperative hand of power behind that. Now, I want to talk about this particular translation because I want to make a point about it a little later on. The folk songs of southern India. I'm going on to the second slide, and you can see here the contents of the book, the folk songs of southern India. It has several sections: Canary songs, Badaga songs, Koorga songs, Tamil songs, the Kural, I suppose that is meant to be Tirukural, Malayalam songs, Telugu songs. Now he calls all of these folk songs, and they belong to different timelines. We do not know if Charles Gower was a polyglot with expertise in all these languages. None of the British translators, G.U. Pope or Griffiths, who said that he was translating the Rig Veda and the Samaveda, completely oblivious of the fact that it was a mnemonic text and a sound-based text. It was not meant to be a semantic text at all. None of these translators ever acknowledge the position and the help rendered to them by the local scholars, without whose help they could never have done this. The book is full of British imperial divide and rule and several other things. I don't want to go into it, but you can read that particular introduction. The book is available in Internet Archive to see the colonial exercise. Now here he has a kind of a hold all. The Kural, it's a classical, belongs to the classical corpus, the southern, the 18 little lower texts, or the southern lower texts, Padinan Kil Kanak. It's dated quite, 1600-1700 years back. In the date is debatable, but definitely before the 5th-6th century. And then you have Tamil songs. He has taken Siddhar Padals. And he has Koorgi songs, Badaga tribal lore, Canary songs, medieval Canaries literature, Kannada literature. He takes esoteric literature, Akka Mahadevi, the songs on Guheshwara. All these, everything is packed under an umbrella title, the folk songs of southern India. And he also has Malayalam songs, all of them belonging to different timelines. Allama Prabhu he has, and then he has Vemanna. They are all esoteric poets. Everything has been signified as folk songs of the folk songs of southern India. And he says in the preface that after a hard day's work, the British scholar deserves a holiday. So he is indulging in some pleasantry and introducing South Indian literature to his British counterpart, much like the so-called innocent letter writing, epistolary writing of the boudoir kind, which the women indulged in. So I want you to see here what translation has actually done in connivance with power, typical Foucauldian situation, where the folk songs of southern India includes everything from a classical text. It is a metaphysical and a didactic text, and all these. Now he says he selected those parts of the Kural which he thinks are good for the British sensibility, which he thinks are the better ones, though he never tells us how he made that choice. Now all these are called folk songs, and today we have a totally different definition of the folk song. Definitely the Kural is not folk song. Allama Prabhu or Akka Mahadevi or the Siddhar Padagal, yes, they were widely sung in simple language, but they were layered with so much of deep meaning. All that is glossed over, ironed out, and then you have this typical production. The point I'm trying to make is, starting from the title to the power of the publication, the politics of publication, the way in which a text is translated could signify how it is pressured into existence by the socio-historical moment of the time. This is a classic example. And I'm giving you positive and negative examples, if you can call it like that. so that I cannot be prescriptive and say these are the, Winston told me talk about strategies as though I have a bag of tools which I can share with you. Nobody can give you the strategies. You have to discover them. You have to discover them by wading into the area and looking at several such examples. So this is the first example that I wanted to share with you, the folk songs of Southern India and how it has been actually translated. I'm using the word in a very literal Shakespearean sense. In A Midsummer Night's Dream, Tuck tells Bottom, Bottom thou art translated. What he means to say is that you're so totally changed, I can't recognize what you are. That's what he means by Bottom thou art translated. So here is a classic use of the Shakespearean semantic total translation, where the whole thing has been pushed into the grid of colonial knowledge, colonial necessity, colonial ideology. So this kind of a translation where there has been a preying upon the text with a total insensitivity to the socio-production of the text, the timeline of the text, the nature of the language. The Kural was written at a time when some of the important nigandus of Tamil were produced. So when you want to understand the semantic range of the words, you have to go to the nigandu of that particular time, not the dictionary of 2000 plus. All that has been overlooked. So the responsibility of the translator, I think we have to go back several times to the much cliched and oft quoted dictum prescribed by Eliot, tradition and individual talent. He says you have to be humble when you approach the text and learn from the text. Now we'll go back to that point a little later on, but I've made a point here in showing you how a translation can become an ideological exercise, and that is something one has to be very careful about. I'm moving on to the next slide. Now see, he classifies these texts that he has chosen as works of the Dravidian Augustan period. Now, nowhere is it clear in the introduction, translator's introduction, whether he was an expert in all these languages, Tulu, the languages of the Badaga community, then Telugu, classical Telugu, medieval Telugu, classical Tamil, modern Tamil, medieval Kannada, later Kannada, early Kannada. He doesn't make it clear, but he has assumed the capacity to take the responsibility of all these translations, and he describes them as works of the Dravidian Augustan period. I do not know whether the Kural and Allama Prabhu, they are in different timelines, Akka Mahadevi, Vemana, they are in different timelines, and Dasarapadas, they are in different timelines and different renderings of the language, different experimentation with language necessitated with a larger social vision. All that, he has called it Augustan, because he says, I'm choosing only those which can be instructive. So I suppose in that sense, he is using the word Augustan, and he calls it Dravidian Augustan period. And the Dasara, now what's interesting in this book is that the book is available in the Internet Archive, as I said. When you feel bored and you want to do something interesting, go to that book and look at it. He has divided the Dasarapadas and given them titles, didactic works, like Bacon's Essay on Goodness, on Charity, like that he has given didactic titles. Then Badaga dirges, he has taken the dirges of the Badaga community, and he says this is another division of literature, because the sense of oppari, as it is known in Malayalam and Tamil, the dirges which are sung for the dead, the eulogizing of the dead, wishing the dead a farewell, fond farewell, all that he divides it into different categories. And as far as Tamil is concerned, he has taken, I can only say the entire section is an anthology of all timelines. So this is the kind of exercise that he has done, the title he has given, the description he has given, assuming or leading us to believe that he is a polyglot with such a deep under the skin knowledge of all these languages. So I suppose we can learn much from this. I'll go on now to the next slide. Now here, there's a modern translation of Allama Prabhu, Vedagu mode. Now we are going on to another kind of translation. Read this poem. It's a literal translation, more or less. I do not know what other kind of translation you can do, because I've experimented with that also. The tiger-headed deer, the deer-headed tiger joined at the waist. Look, another came to chew close by when the trunk with no head grazes dry leaves. Look, all vanishes, O Goeshwara. Obviously, it's a deeply esoteric poem using an esoteric register, which a closed community of practitioners knew. Like Kabir saying, Ulti Naina, you turn your eyes upside down, then you'll be able to look straight, he says. How can you look straight if you turn your eyes upside down? But only those who know Kabir's register, those who know the yogic intention, those who know that all his such esoteric songs are rooted in the inner yoga, they know that it has very deep meanings. Now, when you translate it like this, now you can see the entire depth of the poem, the beauty of the poem, and the intention of the poem, the knowledge of the experience that has pressured the poem into existence. All that, as I said earlier, is ironed out. But then this is one option, unless you make a number of footnotes. I'm going to another example. This is a Tamil, a beautiful composition of several hundreds of songs. I've plucked out one. This is my own translation. Making space, the bow. This could be in caps, actually. Making space, space, the bow. And the five letters, the bowstring, riding the chariot of syllables to hunt the deer in the forest where the sun and moon wander in playful chase, my darling Kannamma, shall I see your splendor. It's in Tamil, it will be Andarathai villaki, Anjalithai nanaki, Mandirathereriyallo, Manvetai adadarku, Chandira Suryarum, Thambavana Kavanathe, Yen Kannamma, Unnalagai Paareno. He's the first person to use this kind of a, you know, appellative, Kannamma, that refers to the yogic power. It also refers to the divine mother. It refers to his beloved. It refers to his girlfriend. It refers to a child. It has a large semantic range. And Bharati, Mahakavi Bharati, took this Kannamma form from Alguni Siddhar. Alguni means a crybaby. He's all the time weeping for grace. And I have given the title Kannamma songs. He didn't give any title. He has hundreds and hundreds of them. We don't know how many hundreds. We have some with us. Now here, this makes no sense to a foreign reader or even to even our own readers. Why must we assume that we are familiar with our regional literature? We just wouldn't make sense unless I burdened the poem with footnotes, and I'll have to do it so sparingly and yet responsibly so that some amount of meaning is rendered. So translation of these kind of verses. Now, this is the kind of problem you will see in Goa. I'm moving on with some more examples. Once we look at all the examples, we'll move on to a more theoretical base. I'm going to the next slide now. In translator, I say culture writes the text. So we saw that. We saw three examples. It's a concept and it's referred via specific vocabulary items. So what is that bow and what is that space? It has a universal meaning. It's a universal signifier. It also has a specific function. The above may be general universal, but expressed specific to the source language culture. So what I'm trying to say here is that I'm going back to my title, Literary and Cultural Semiotics. Is it enough that you have competence in two languages, or do you have to also toil to learn more, to love more cultures, to know more cultures, to get under the skin of other cultures, to become humble and to appreciate it? I'm using the word humble again for the second time, although I know it's very old-fashioned and we don't hear the word much these days. And with my gray hair, I think I can say that. I'm using that word because I learned that when I was translating folk and tribal tales. It really makes you humble. I approached it casually, but it's really fascinating how deeply meaningful it can be and how humorous it can be and how very strangely experimental it can be. You feel humbled when you look at that kind of literature. So that's why I say that you have to approach the source language, not only the language, but also its culture, so that you arrive at extra-textual, meta-textual dimensions of the text, which need to be considered for a holistic translation of the text. So you have to decide what kind of responsibility you are going to assume as a translator. Is it going to be a holistic translation, or is it going to be a literal? Even this big debate about literal and dynamic equivalence has been going on. But we can actually see it in play. We can see the tension between the two when you take even a simple folk tale. Okay? Now, I'm moving on a little bit more. I'm going on to the next. Specific registers require specific address. See, the tone, certain word endings, certain expletives, L.K. Brathwaite, when he talks about nation language, he talks about the damage done to the Caribbean languages by the imposition of English. He says there are some words in the native African tongue, many languages of Africa which came there and which eventually became a kind of a Caribbean language. He says a number of these words don't have specific meanings, but they are very, very expressive and they are a vital part of the language. Like you say, ayo, amma, adada, oh, ho, ho, things like that. Just the intonation and the sound for the regional speaker, it means such a lot. Somebody tells you something and surprise, you say, oh. And someone tells you something, sort of, you say, oh. So the way in which you intone, he says, all this is lost. Where is my language? He asks. So it becomes very difficult in certain genres. That's why I called the first part of my lecture, actually, I should have had here somewhere, genre matters, matters relating to genre. I don't know, I've lost that slide. I was very happy because it sounded good. Genre matters, I had called it, matters relating to genre, where the genre of the text, it is not a literary genre we are talking about. It's a holistic genre that we are talking about, because the text is always bursting at the seams and spilling on to the social, historic, religious, economic, you know, gender-based. So many other factors come into the play of the text, in the production of the text. So specific registers require specific address. Footnotes and glossary, though cumbersome, sometimes they demand space. In the folk tales, I have done that. I have used it because somewhere I could not manage. You see, it's very easy to understand folklore and folk literature if you have enough traffic with your regional language and some other regional languages. Almost throughout, in some three or four languages that I can fairly move about comfortably, I find that so much of similarities are there. One day I was just sitting with a friend and I said, and we were kind of indulging in wordplay. For every word I said in Tamil, she gave me a Gujarati counterpart. For example, in Tamil Nadu, there is the habit. Supposing in a family, children are born and in infancy, they keep dying, they make a vow. And when a child is born and survives, they name the child Pichai. That is, it is got as a charity from God. Pichayamma, Pichandi, Pichai, like that. Bhiksha, it is Bhiksha. Now, Pichai is a name that's given, or Pichayamma is a name that's given in Tamil Nadu. And she said, we have Bhikalal, we have the same thing. The child is placed outside the house in the dustbin and brought in. Exactly the same tradition is there. And the child is called Bhikalal or Bhikabai or something like that. So I'm not trying to universalize it and say that it has a common culture. Yes, it has a common culture. And we don't have to feel shy about saying that. When it comes to oral literature, you can see so much of similarities. And you can move about easily. But when you bring it into English, then you have to put it through that particular, you know, what shall we say, frame. You have, like Cinderella's slipper, you have to chop the feet to fit into it, because so much of it is not there. Another difficulty that you have, regional language to English, is that generally in regional languages, particularly so in Sanskrit, for each word you have umpteen possibilities. That is why they prepared so many different types of thesaurae in those times. And at each point of time, they prepared a thesaurus because the words kept on adding. Now, you don't have such a large semantic range in English, but then English is the most plastic and easy language to learn and to use. So it becomes easy to approximate into English rather than actually translate. That would be a very high demand that's made of us. One can constantly try sincerely to approximate. So footnotes and glossary are cumbersome, but sometimes they demand space. And the genre could discourage the presence of both the author and the translator. Take any of Kabir's Doha, or you take a song by, I've read Akka Mahadevi only in translation, Akka Mahadevi, or Vemana, which I could read in Telugu, or Tamil Siddha Padal. Siddhar songs, there is nothing about the author's experience sitting on the, you know, I look at the daffodils and I think about it again. No, he has no place in the text. There is a certain burden of meaning, a certain experience that is described that blossoms while the words keep running on the page. That's all that matters. And the translator also has to step out of the text, stand far away and facilitate that meaning. And the stylistic aesthetic as well as the semantic content as much as possible. So the genre itself decides the nature of the translation. Now then, see this. Linguistics oriented approaches, which were original in translation studies in the beginning stages, do not accommodate the concept of ideology. They don't accommodate that. When it is just linguistic based translation, then it becomes very restrictive. Now I've made some points here based on Gova and based on the kind of texts that are there. And from there, I took, looking at some of the texts that he has translated, I made a point about the difficulty of esoteric texts, taking a cue from there. From there, I'll move on to another kind of genre altogether. I've used my text not to advertise it, but because I want to point out a very significant feature here. For the first time, my book brought out in the title Folk and Tribal Tales, because tribal tales were never seen as an independent body of literature. It was always subsumed under folklore, which could be urban, it could be semi-rural, or it could be totally rural. Whereas tribal tales are a very ancient and very specific body of literature, deeply anchored in performance and in a very stylized manner. It cannot be simply pushed into one corner and say, okay, you can sit in the back seat. It's a very, very responsible and knowledgeable body of words, because you see, their knowledge about the landscape, the use of the landscape, the use of the environment, how to protect it, the sacred grove concept. Deep ecology is today going back to tribal knowledge in a very humble way. Again, I'm using the word. In a very responsible way to learn environmental sustenance and so on. So all that knowledge is in the language itself, in the day-to-day language. So when the landscape is lost and the language is lost, we also lose a body of knowledge. But we'll come back to that later on. This is the reason why I wanted to showcase this particular title. So when we go to folklore, and tribal lore, I said, is something different. I'll go to a specific tribal tale that I translated for a tribal ballad that I translated for Satya Academy. Before that, folk lore. Here you have proverbs, riddles, and wordplay. I have seen my great-grandmother till I was in my BA first year. She was almost 100 when she passed, both my great-grandmother and great-grandfather. And I mention this because my great-grandmother could never speak without proverbs. So also my grandmother. Today, in a class where I have students from different parts of India, if I teach translation studies, which I sometimes do, if I tell them, write down 5 proverbs in your mother tongue, not even half the class is able to do that. And these proverbs are capsules of wisdom, churned out of the experience of life. It's just floated out of life like that. And some time back, I think about 30, 40 years ago, there was an attempt to bring all the proverbs in different parts of the regional of India in different regional languages, the so-called bigger languages, smaller languages, in terms of speaker and history. speakers, number and history, all that in one kind of a series. Some books did come out, but that was not a complete series. And it's amazing how the proverbs also give you a clue to the history of the times. I'll give one example. In Tamil, there is a proverb which says, "Aase irukku thasil panna, adrishtam irukku aadu meka." At one point of the colonial history, being a tahsildar was a big deal because he was the biggest officer for all the villagers. So the aasha is to become a tahsildar, but the adrishta, the bhagya, is only to herd goats. So see, in that proverb, you have a certain clue to colonial history. I'm not saying we have to build a history from proverbs, but what I'm trying to say is that it resonates with life. And then you have riddles with children, which I, in my childhood, so many riddles. Actually, these riddles, you know, help the child to prepare the tongue to speak nicely, wordplay, then songs, birth songs, naming, celebrating, fertility rites, puberty. All this you can find in folklore, harvesting of the seasons, then festive occasions, domestic chores, wedding, death, everything, and cosmogenesis. My God, it's so interesting. Every part of the country has its own theory of cosmogenesis, and it will claim that life began from there. It will be, the folktale will be from a tiny little village which doesn't even have connectivity by phone. But when you look at the cluster of folktales, all of them will say this is where it all started. The folktales will define how the cosmos took its shape from there. Then defining man, his relationship to the world, it's simultaneously cosmic and extremely regional, and folk tales traffic without boundaries. When people move from place to place, they take their folk tales, their proverbs and their idioms with them. So when you translate such literature, you have to be very responsible and ensure that you're not making something exotic so that it sells well in the market. And also because it's a new academic, platform that you can enjoy for a while. So making exotic, that has to be avoided, and retaining the, not the residue, but the rest of the text. Retaining the rest of the text, source text. So in folk tales and tribal tales, we have to definitely accommodate the cultural semiotics as equally as we do its linguistic and semantic content. Now let me go on to the next slide. Now I'm going to look at a tribal ballad, the ballad of Joginandamma. It's sung by women when they work in forests, and indeed are all the ballads of the Irula tribe. Now I translated 5 ballads of the Irula tribe, and one of them was for the Sahitya Academy's 50th, that Golden Jubilee thing. This Joginandamma is one of the 5. There's no hard and fast rule that only women sing these songs. It's a common inheritance. Now, ballads are not necessarily ancient. There is a ballad very close by to Pondicherry in Kadalur district, where in that ballad, the woman says, "See, my feet are burning." She's burning, working in the Chunam quarry, and she wants to go home. And in the song, she says, "I haven't seen my child since I left him in the cradle this morning." She's tied an old cloth to the tree, and she's put her baby there, and she's been working in this Chunam quarry, and she wants to go home. She's tired. She's worried about the baby. Now, that ballad will have no meaning because we don't have those quarries, and it's no longer done manually. And so you have ballads that are very, very contemporary or near contemporary, and you also have these ancient ballads. Now, the tribal ballads are a very serious body of human knowledge. This particular one is about incest. A child, a small child of 5, how she is misused, and finally she is made brothers. She has 5 brothers. The wives of the brothers don't want her shame in the family. They drown her in the waters, and she becomes an immortal fish. That is the ballad. She gets into the water and becomes a golden fish. So it means that they actually killed her by ducking her into the river. So it's a very pathetic tale, and usually tribal ballads are very disturbing because they are so raw with truth, so raw with the pain of life. Now, this particular one is about Jogi Nandamma. She becomes a Jogi. She becomes deified after her death. And so the prefix Jogi is given to her. That's just an introduction. Now, this has got totally I think I must have aligned this several times, but repeatedly it has, something has gone wrong. So for the headman, Kuniyam Open Jogi Nandama, 6 children, 6 sons, 5 were married, only 1 son was not married. And she comes behind, oh Ayyade or Ayyade. The wife comes behind the husband and says, Ayyade, Ayyade, we have no daughter. Let's go to the forest and pray to the forest mother for a daughter. They pray. They are blessed with a girl child. I have put one here because I have a note there. I have a footnote there. So this actually is a small song. Tribal songs are all very small. If you put them in print, it will be about 3/4 of a page. But they will sing it the whole night. So where is the music, the performance, the participation of the community? See, instead of giving a didactic sermon, when they sing this song, then there is a caution. See, this is how you live. Just as Oedipus said, I'm not going to acquit myself. I'm going to suffer so that for all times to come, man will remember that this is something that should not be done. Because if I acquit myself, then everyone say, oh, the great Oedipus himself did such a blunder, indulged in such a moral transgress. So what is wrong? They will question, like, that is the reason why he punishes himself, although he has the power to acquit himself and matures into a wise man. So Oedipus's infinite suffering is consciously done there. Similarly, when you look at these kind of ballads, you know, they are didactic. They are pathetically human and they are didactic. At the end of the song, you also pity the youngster who has actually caused indirectly or directly caused the death of the small girl, the young man who's actually one of her youngest, the last of her elder brothers. So he's also in, I'm not acquitting him, but his point of view is also accommodated there, like Shakespeare allowing Edmund to talk in King Lear. So the tribal ballads, we must not assume, like the colonial scholar did, that oral literature, tribal and folk literature, is something inferior to print literature. In many ways, it's superior to print literature. It's deeply imbibed with a sense of human well-being. That is the intention. So here I have this. Now I have a plain text on the page. Ignore all the misalignment that has happened again and again. Yeah, if I'd made it into a PDF, that wouldn't have happened. I want you to simply see, all I can give you is the print text, which is one of the versions. I can have infinite versions. Every time they sing it, they will change it according to the context and the audience. But I freeze it to a single print text and then give you only the words. I'm not giving you all the performance. The performativity of the text is not here. So this is what happens when you translate tribal ballads, and then you have to bulwark the whole thing and support it with a lot of what shall we say, footnotes. Another way is to digitize the actual performance and to preserve it. That is also done. Now there's another side to the story. I'll go to that later. So now let's move on to a little more complicated part. Who is competent to translate, to preserve and facilitate this corpus of life literature? It should be really a person from that particular tribe or that particular community who will have a deep experience and knowledge of all that the words mean in relation to their life. That is assuming people still live that kind of life. Now, I'll be doing just what Gower did when I did this book. It sells well, but I'm more or less being Gower all over again because I don't belong to the Irula tribe. And I am only taking it 2 times removed from reality. First, bringing it into a standard Tamil, see here, is the process just that is Irula. There is a glossary in Tamil that was prepared by an anthologist, colleague of mine. From there, I bring it to standard Tamil and to English, and I rob the text of all its performance. This is one way of preserving one of its versions. So is a complete translation devoid of performativity? Now, this is what I want you to understand by the word semiotics in my title. Is it the linguistic burden? Is it the cultural suggestion? Or is it performativity and the whole of the text? What is it that you have to attend to when you're translating? And now with the help of, the state of the art equipment, we can digitize what little is left of Irula ballads were 11 in number. Only 4 are Irula epics, only 4 are available. And of that, only 2 are complete. The others are fragmented. And this is one example among the thousands all over India. One of my Sikkimi student, she comes from the Lepcha tribe of the upper Sikkim. Her PhD topic was to collect the Limbu epic of the Sikkimese Lepcha tribe, translate it, digitize it, and prepare a glossary. That was her PhD topic. And there also you have a frozen version, but you have at least one version, which will be a residue of what is going to be lost. Even there, 2 chapters were missing. Although she searched all over Sikkim, she couldn't find anyone to sing those 2 chapters. No one had a clue. It was lost over time. So the complete translation of certain genres, I really feel bad that slide is lost because it was such a nice slide. I had written genre matters and I had put a bar there and written matters of genre. So genre matters. You have to approach a text via the grid of its genre, its cultural and linguistic genre, both at the same time. Instead of simply looking at it, you have to look at it 3-dimensionally, not flatly as a page of words. And is it just a group of words? Is a ballad of this kind just a group of words? What is the text here? You have a translation, you read it, it makes sense and it can be very moving. But I know that I've given you only a portion of the text. Unless you actually hear the ballad and see the performance, it's not really possible to give you the entire translation. As I said, now with digitizing it, there is an excellent opportunity to, what are the other options? Now I'm going on to the next slide. Now see, over a period of time, notions of originality of the text, especially in the post-structural context, that has shifted in what was called the cultural turn of the 90s, which made a very big impact on translation exercises and translation theory. Culture becomes operational, not the words of the text, because the words of the text are all breathing, drawing sustenance from what is behind them. And the author's superiority over the translator, that is also questioned, because Venushi, he talks as both the author and the translator being a part of a chain of production. The text is producing itself. And here I would also like to, add the name of Gideon Turi and also Gadama, who speak about how your own language and your own linguistic and cultural ambience decides what you understand of the world. So I suppose that bears a lot of truth for translation also, because you're going to read the source text, you're going to read everything around the source text, and you are also going to get into the literary timeline of that language and make yourself knowledgeable about it, instead of taking the 2 texts and a dictionary of the 2 languages and sitting down to translate. So the human factor, how it mediates or how it monitors the, assumption of the text and its rendering of the text in translation, these people have spoken about it extensively in their theory. And then we have also shifted from absolute equivalence to relationship between signs in the post-structural context. Not that translation all over the world is affected by that. I'm simply using the term post-structural context because we are familiar with it, that's all. I'm quoting from Turi. Any translated text shows a certain correspondence with the original. By the fact of being its translation, it has to correspond to the original, and it also deviates from it because of the interference of the target system in its production. We saw the interference of the target system in folklore. We saw the interference of the target system in the translation of Tirukural. These deviations, which have always been regarded as negative phenomena, that is loss, addition, departure from the text, are the evidence of those factors determining translation performance beyond linguistic rules. This is the main phrase here, beyond linguistic rules. Translation is translation by virtue of both equivalence and difference. Now let's go to the next one. Now let's look at two perspectives. Post-structuralist textuality. Post-structuralism is not a Western invention. It's a very recent invention, but it's useful to use that grid here. Redefines the notion of equivalence in translation by assuming from the outset that the differential plurality in every text, I can read Vemana as a text in itself, as a beautiful piece of poetry, and go home happily. I can also read it as a yogic text. The differential plurality in every text precludes a simple correspondence of meaning, that this is what it means, and a ratio of loss and gain inextricably occurs during translation process. So Venushi talks about death of the author, later found its way into translation studies also. Please stand outside the text. So when you take it to the extreme, it seems that the text can never be translated wholly, that every translation is a kind of an approximation. Now, another very radical view, let's look at another one. The Latin American writers, in resistance to the realism of Europe, they started writing their fiction, which is now fancifully called magical realism. But they were really writing the way they were looking at the world, like our folk tales. A little boy who has lost his father asks his mother, "Where's my father?" And the mother doesn't want to tell him that he's no more. She points to the sun and says, "This is your father." This is a folk tale from Tamil Nadu, in one of the regions of Tamil Nadu. The boy is so innocent and his faith is so complete, he actually travels and reaches the sun. And the son gives him a tiny box and says, you have everything you need here. Don't open it on the way. Go home and then give it to your mother and ask her to open it. But the boy in his curiosity opens it. And from there jump out animals and trees and mountains and rivers and places and people. The whole cosmos comes into being. Now, this is a tale. This is magical realism, but it happens in a folk tale. And folk tales are often heavily slanted upon epics. You can see so many versions of it. The Muduvan epics are totally based on stories from the Mahabharata. One of my research scholars worked on Muduvan Ashapat, the love songs of the Muduvans. Now here you see a kind of a world vision that defies the reason and the empirical reasoning of Western writing of the 18th and 19th century, which is something the realism of Europe is what magical realism is resisting. And an extreme view of that is posited by Haroldo de Campos, Anthropophagia. That is, he says you devour the text and then you regurgitate it. You bring it out again as a totally different thing. He had an essay, look at the title of the essay. It looks as if Mephisto-Faustian transluciferation. Thomas Kidd would have liked that title. Christopher Marlowe would have been very happy to see a title like that. So when he's talking about a total translation, a transcreation, a hyper-translation, so that is a kind of a rage, a literary rage that comes into play in Latin American writings, where the novel of realism is turned totally upside down. It's refashioned altogether, a Gower exercise in reverse. There Gower ate it up with his imperial power. Here, there is a political resistance, a cultural resistance to the realism, and their folklore, their narrative style finds way through fiction writing. So this is a kind of a translation, and the canonical texts of the West are taken and they become the foundation for these texts. So this is a kind of an extreme translation that takes place, an ideological translation, but that has also happened. So two very extreme views where the text is taken as it is with a respect for its plurality, and in another where the whole thing is refashioned altogether. Now let's move here. So there are two views now. I'm going back to oral literatures, supporting the exercise to preserve endangered languages versus what is being preserved, why and how. Now, if you want the language to retain the knowledge of the landscape of indigenous medicine and science, then people have to live there and live with that landscape. But how long should they live there? Why should they walk 3 miles to go to the nearest hospital? Why should not they have schools? You have to lay roads. You have to share all that you have got with them. So what happens is when the landscape changes, many words fall off, the language changes. And many of my, many research scholars of mine and well as students who come from the Northeast, many of them cannot speak their mother tongue. Because the move towards another landscape, another way of life has overwritten those languages with the language that is now in current usage. So there, if you ask what is your mother tongue, there's no notion of second language. One of my Anglo-Indian scholars, she had to fill up the form, mother tongue, English, second language, English. That's your mother tongue, because English has now become more than a language. It's just a facility like the mobile. It's everybody's. So here you have a British linguist who brought up this question, a very sensible question. Peter Ladd-Foged. He actually, the sound of world languages, you can read up a little bit about him. He's done so much of work in phonetics. He was the first person to use state-of-the-art equipment for, studying linguistics. He says linguists should record languages, not try to save them. Though he predicted that except for some, most of the world's 6,500 languages will become extinct. He says, how can you preserve it? What you'll be preserving is actually a carcass, like my translation of the ballad. Because the landscape has changed, the people have changed, the traffic between man and his landscape have changed. Now, why must you expect them to speak the language? Preserving languages could weaken national unity. This is a radical view he had. That was his point of view. Encourage tribalism and absorb scarce resources that might otherwise be used for development. These were his views. And throughout his life, he was arguing for that with enough examples from Africa and Asia and Canada and Australia, etc. He didn't just say it out of his hat. Deciding what language people should speak is not our decision to make. It is up to the people themselves. So there is also the other thing, like when you translate, what language you are translating is a very important point, especially if you want a good publisher to bring out your book. So how are you doing it? To put it in very simple, honest language, we are actually showcasing our folklore in one sense. I'm doing what Govar is doing, but with lesser guilt because it's my own language. So let me move on to the last slide. So what are the factors that impress upon translation and understanding the genre of the text? Competence in as many related languages as possible. If someone thinks I know two languages and I can translate, I'm not sure whether you're going to be completely successful or at least hugely successful. Knowledge of the literature and its timeline development in the two languages at least is mandatory. A basic knowledge of the literary and social history and knowledge of the traditions and singularities of the source text and the target text. So I think I have kept to the time. So I would like to conclude with this.
Hello, ma'am. It was a very interesting session. And I am also working on folklore. So it was especially very much related to my area as well. Ma'am, actually, I wanted to share something with you, and I wanted to follow up with a question. So recently, I was reading about Sang and Nautanki, soap operas that are being performed in Haryana and Uttar Pradesh. So the only translation that was available out there was by a Britisher, R.C. Temple. Sadhana Natani also talks about it. So it like makes me wonder where the, like, because it was translated and that is the only literature that translation that is available, where does the original stands there? Because there is actually the oral literature has no mention in his documentation. So where the original lies in it? Because when we are translating something specifically in a post-colonial context, it becomes very important to highlight the original as well. So this is somewhere I am like in a middle of it and not understanding how to like actually find the original of it. Like, because there is like nothing available and no one has tried to look it up as of now.
Okay, Kanika, you've raised a question and answered it yourself. But if you are going to look at Nautanki, you have to actually go to the performance. That's what I was trying to say throughout. And why are you disturbed about the partial translation of a Britisher? That doesn't have any bearing upon an original piece of work that you do. You can learn from it. You can learn what not to do from it. And actually go to the field. Unless you go to the field, you should not dabble with oral literatures, performance literatures. So that is where the source text really begins.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Ma'am, is the underlying philosophy of tribal culture and folk culture same?
I don't think there are two points. First of all, you can't make a hard division of line of tribal and folk literature or tribal and folk people today.
Yes.
Because of all the migration towards metropolitan cities in search of labor. And there are very few genuine tribal pockets. So it's a little difficult. The boundaries have become porous and it's difficult to identify them. Tribal can adapt. You go to Jharkhand, so many of them have come to the cities, Ranchi, other places. So the identity has become porous now. So we can't assume that they are two different things altogether, although they are, culturally they are. Secondly, if you look at it from the linguistic and cultural point of view, yes, definitely. The term folk could mean us also. Mm. It could mean any specific community. Mm. But when you say tribal, it's rooted in a landscape. It's rooted in a history. It's rooted in a language. It's rooted in systems of belief. And it's rooted in a way of life. So they have a very, very deep sense of commitment to life. In the tribal pockets that are surviving, there's a lot that we can learn. So tribal culture is something very distinct. Although, because of social migration, boundaries are becoming porous. Essentially, they are different. But the term folk, you can also use it when you talk about tribes, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Folk is a descriptive term. Tribal is a nomenclature.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, welcome.
Ma'am, these days there is a lot of talk about Nanjamma and her song, which was popularized by that film. So do we go by that?
One rendering.
Okay.
Film is one rendering. So how can I answer a question like that honestly?
Mm.
Is a rendering. Even a song that is sung by a tribe or a community will change from time to time.
Okay.
They will improvise. It's a very fluid thing. Oral literatures are fluid. It's not frozen. Like, that's why you use the word frozen. Frozen print literature versus the fluidity, the self-generating quality of, you know, oral literatures. Actually, you know, I don't know whether I should say this, but it's there in my mind, and why not say it? every, say, 10 years or 15 years, we pounce upon something new to survive academically. So it's structuralism, then post some new criticism when I was in MA, formalism and all that. My professor was a student of I.A. Richards, straight from Oxford at Hyderabad University, first batch. So then after that, post-structuralism, then post-colonialism. Now we are wading into new areas, translation. As that is actually academic survival. If you can deconstruct the whole thing and say, now you give me one more hour, Winston, I'll deconstruct my own lecture.
Actually, see? In linguistics, it's a famous thing known that in MIT, you know, every professor in every 7 years they have to submit those things. So you see,
you have to make a theory in order to survive. I don't know if you've read a beautiful article by Barbara Christian. African American critic. She writes, she has an essay entitled The Race for Theory, and she's punning on the word race. She's talking about the Black American race, and she's also talking about the running race, the race for theory. She's an academic. She says you have to create a theory to survive, otherwise you are not taken seriously. But we are a race who don't believe in theory. Whatever we speak, our stories are our theories, our stories are our philosophy. The African and Asian, there are a lot of similarities. So in that essay, you know, she actually talks about this particular concept, The Race for Theory by Barbara Christian. Short essay available on the web. You can read it.
Even the documentation through, like, of the performance that you were talking about, they are also like, we lose a dimension of the, you know, the lighting in that area and the dress sense, which is about.
You're going to fill. You're talking about filming it. I'm talking about documenting it. There's a lot of difference. You're filming it, you're going to make them sit in a particular way, adjust your light. No. This is when the actual performance happens, when there is a wedding. You take permission and you simply sit quietly in the middle of all the din, you record it. That's different. Documentation is different from filming. Thank you.